Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was to him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people. A man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way, but the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to slaughter or a sheep before the shears, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and will pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey in him. The word of the Lord.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Jesus went out with his apostles across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Jesus, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Who are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus, the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Jesus, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus, the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into the scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest as he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
he said.
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there, keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered him and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wore a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
"Behold, the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away. Take him away and crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled, that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened, so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial clothes, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now, in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In this morning's paper, I saw an article that was going into some of the European reaction to the current issue in Ukraine. We're not allowed to call it war if we're in Russia. And he said it was a German prime minister who was in a coalition government. If you know about coalition governments, they can fall apart really fast. But he got up, he's a lefty, left-leaning person, and he got up and said one thing. It's a change of the times. And everybody got up and applauded. The German parliament has finally decided to do things, not because so much they are frightened, but because the world order that has been building up since the Second World War has collapsed. We can't depend on anything that we used to depend on when we were responding or reacting to things. And most of the West has been living a pretty good, solid life. I mean, we go along, we see things far away from us, and we wonder if they can touch us. They might touch us emotionally, but they don't touch us on other things until the gas prices go up. Or you go into a supermarket, like I did last week, and I looked at some of the beef and I said, no way, Jose. I went right to the hamburger and that was still up. And I thought, you know, if this goes on, I'm gonna become a vegetarian. But that's what happens. Things start impinging. And now we're on the surface, but in some ways, in many ways, we're gonna have to go deeper. We're gonna have to go deeper than we have been living for a while. And it's not just economics, it's the way the world's gonna run. It's not gonna run like it used to. I don't know what's gonna happen to the United Nations. That was established after the Second World War, and it is now, the Security Council is chaired by Russia. And the Prime Minister in Ukraine, Zelensky, brought out the fact that that was a kind of a odd thing. Just have somebody at the head of the Security Council who's actually invading another country. So all of that stuff looks like it's going. But does that mean disaster, or does that mean something else? It's going to be a realignment. And for the first time in 70, 80 years, Europe is united like it's never been united before. So there's a positive thing that comes out of a negative thing. People in Europe may be worried about where they're going to get their energy, but they're not worried about where they live, because everywhere in their geographic area, even though there are all kinds of different languages and people, all of a sudden they are together. And that's a positive thing. But still, let's go down deeper than the positive. What's going to happen when all of us individually have to find out in ourselves what level we're going to reach? Are we going to reach a level that's going to be, I'm preaching right now, let's say superficial. Because a lot of the things we do day by day, although they're absolutely necessary, you know, we have to eat meals, we have to clean our clothes, we have to do all kinds of stuff just, you know, for the day-by-day stuff. But in a way, that's just building up for what we're really supposed to be doing. What are we really supposed to be doing? And when we can't do anything about what's going on in Ukraine or some other place of the world, like Ethiopia, well, you know, you can give some money to a relief organization, or you could just pray for them. But when it gets closer and closer, what's happening and how are we going to really respond to it? What are we going to do for the rest of our lives when the world around us is not going to be like it has been since 1945? And that's an interesting question, because it's going to impinge on us. This election in 2022 is going to be a lot of talk about where the United States should be going. How are we responding to the world situation we're in? What are we going to do about China? What are we going to be able to do? You know, I went through all the stuff, like my clothes and my ski boots. It's amazing how much is made in China. So if we ever get in trouble with China, we're going to have a big deal with our economy. Well, what's that going to mean? But I can't do a thing about that. So we go deeper. We go deeper into our participation in our common humanity and the people we live with and the decisions we make day by day, hoping that we're making better decisions most of the time and not bad decisions. And then we come to church here today, and we're asked to go really deep. We're asked to see what happened to Jesus. You know, for some reason, good people will react when bad has been done. When evil is there, we'll stand up, just like they're doing in Europe. We will stand up against it. We will say, no, this is wrong, this is evil. But you go down deeper and say, well, how does this even start? Where did we get these people that like to do this kind of thing? And does it look like me? Do I get angry all the time and take it out on other people? So you got somebody who's running a government with a big army, and he gets angry. Do I have that share in his anger? Well, I'm doing the same thing he's doing, but on a smaller level. And we looked at Jesus, and he didn't go to the big men. It was obvious from the reading of the Passion, he had not spent a lot of time with Pilate, nor did he worry about Caesar. The only time he was confronted about that was when somebody brought up a couple coins and asked, are you going to pay the tax? And he said, well, give to Caesar what's Caesar, but give to God what's God. And that was the end of that. And he was probably in contention with the religious leaders, but normally the smaller types, you know, the Pharisees in a local synagogue. It wasn't until they started sending people from the temple priests that Jesus knew that he was really getting engaged with the people who ran the religious and social life of the Jews. And they didn't like him. And he realized that he had to go up to Jerusalem to settle the situation, because his situation was a lot like all the other situations in human history. He had to face the evil of people who wanted to keep him from talking about the mercy of God and about eternal life that could be given to everybody, ordinary or not. And he was saying things that they really got upset about. And pretty soon, he was saying them in a way that implied that he was better than a human being. As the Passion said, this man claimed that he was God. I mean, that's blasphemy. Well, not to the Romans. The Romans, you know, they were deifying their Caesars. So what's the difference between him and another God? But to the Jews, there was only one God. And that was Jesus's problem. How to explain himself? And he couldn't. He was facing evil. Not only mistrust or disagreement, he was facing people who hated him. Have you ever met somebody who really hated you? What do you do with that? Especially when they have power. Especially in an age where people who are put off out of the society, they're apt to be punished, and their punishments are harsh. And so he said, nope, the Father's will forward. And then we go to another level, down. This man who taught wonderful things and who a week before was hailed when he came into the city, today is taken out and everybody's jeering at him. And they're yelling, we don't want him, crucify him. What was the change? He was going down too deep. Everyone likes to know that they're wonderful people. Not everybody likes to know that they participate in the evil they don't like around them. Everybody would like to think of themselves as good persons, but we all have to face in a mirror, a mirror that's full of grace, that we were part of all of this in some sense. That's why we're here. We want to have that lifted off of ourselves. And where was that lifted off of us? Go down deeper. Jesus bore all of that. He bore all the wars of the world. He bore all the hatreds. He bore all the anxieties. He bore all the little petty sinners who say, well, you know, what's a white lie? That's no big deal. Well, the lies keep on building up. And Jesus said, that's going to have to be all on me now. The world is going to come to a crisis, a decision. But the decision wasn't the world. Nobody in the world besides Jesus was making that decision. The one who made it was Jesus himself. He said, if it's the Father's will, and this is going to do something to solve the human predicament, then I will do it. Obedient love. And he carried the whole thing. And he still carries the whole thing. But there's a big difference now. He carried it to the cross, nailed there, and as he gave himself up to God, as he gave his life back to the Father, something was going on with God himself. God in his Trinity was not making a decision, because a decision had been made from all eternity, but what he was doing was saying, it's finished. It has been on this human being who is my divine son. The questions that the human beings raise all the time have been answered. Well, we won't see that a lot, but go down another depth. Go down to the place where Jesus is now. And he's standing, you know, if you trip down, well, I was going to say you trip down too far, you're going to get burned, you know. But, yeah, this imagery of going down, I don't mean that Jesus is, well, he did. There's a theory that he went down into hell and offered everybody there a chance for salvation. Would they hear him and accept him in faith? And either you were sealed in holiness and taken out of hell, or you were sealed in evil, and there you were for the rest of your eternity. But we go down deep enough, and what will we see? If we go down deep enough, what will we encounter? I think one of the things we might see is someone there, and he's standing next to a cross, and he's saying, come along with me. The cross took everything away from you that you wanted to take away in order to see God. And don't so much think of me as how much I suffered, because my suffering was free. My suffering was love. And your suffering will be free in love. But remember, there's an out to this. Come to me. The cross is there, and there is this Jesus. And you will pick up specks of his glory until that's all we'll see, him in glory. Come, follow me. Be with me. And everything, in a sense, in the end, will be satisfied in righteousness. It will be eternal life winning. The cross says evil will never win. God will always win. He won it against our sins. He won it against opposition. He won everything that he needed in order to have his son standing there and say, come along.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may give glory to God the Father Almighty. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishop, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Let us pray. Let us rise.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people governed by their Maker may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Bishop Bernard, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Let us kneel.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the great gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness for all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith of understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may join together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Let us kneel.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter in the way of salvation. Let us kneel.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us also pray for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord only may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God, the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because of their hour of need. Your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the war in Ukraine, let us pray for the people there in all war zones of the world. For those who have fled the dread of violence and have been deprived of their homes, for all men and women who stand up with their lives to ward off evil and to protect the weak and the persecuted. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty and eternal God, you have compassion for the lowly and the poor, but you throw down oppressors. As you guided Israel out of slavery in Egypt, so in our days save all victims of war and violence. Change the hearts of evildoers, and let peace be victorious. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
This time I'd like to invite everyone please to be seated for our collection. Our collection today is, as always, for the Holy Land. If you'd like to write a check out, you can write it to Immaculate Heart of Mary, put in the memo to the Holy Land.
Okay.
time I'd like to invite everyone to stand as we reverence the cross.
Behold the wound of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore.
We need to genuflect for a brief moment. Let us stand.
Behold the wound of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Behold the wound of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore. Thank you.
stand together. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
We invite you now, please, to kneel. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow down for the blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.